Hello, everyone. Welcome back to another, I want to call it episode all the time, but welcome back to another session of CybHER Conversations. I'm Kanti. I'm the director for the CybHER Institute. Today, I have with me a special guest, Jennifer Cox. Jennifer is at Tenable. She's from Ireland, and she's a huge advocate for women in cybersecurity. Jennifer, thank you so much for being here with us today. The floor is all yours.
Thank you so much for having me. I've been proper excited about being here since we discussed it and decided to go ahead with it. I want to tell you a little bit about me. So my name is Jennifer, or Jenny, some people will call me, or even Jen, whatever, I don't mind. And yes, I'm from Ireland, born and raised. I kind of fell into technical roles. I never originally intended to go into anything remotely technical. In fact, when I was in school, my guidance counselor, which is like the Irish equivalent of a careers teacher, told me that I should go into teaching or computers. So bear in mind, in the 1990s, there wasn't specific areas of computers to go into. You just went into computers because there was probably half a dozen types of computers at the time. And I remember specifically thinking, I don't know if I want to do that, for two reasons. One, it was something that boys did, and two, it was something that wasn't cool at the time, I thought. So I went on and did a number of different other things with my career. I studied theater. I was big into it, not necessarily on stage, but doing a lot of behind the scenes things. And then later in my career, I studied psychology because people are always going to be interesting. And I genuinely didn't think I would ever end up in tech. But then back 18 years ago, which is a crazy long time, I guess, but I went to work for a technical company, and I took a role where I would be logging cases into a queue for a support team. Something nice and simple: answer the phone, take all the information, write it all down, and pop it into a queue for people to be able to pick it up and answer the questions. So the technical people were on the other side of the wall as such from me. And then I discovered that, you know, when the people that were answering all the questions were really busy and stressed out, I wanted to help. Actually, that's what you do. You're a human. So when the calls were coming in and people were asking me questions, if I would know the answers or would remember them from different answers that had been given, I would give them the answers and then just close the case before I sent it back into the queue. And I got good enough at that to be able to do as many as anybody else that was in the support team at the time. So I went for a job in the support team, and I got moved in there because of my ability to close so many cases. Bear in mind, I still technically didn't have any degree or qualification in the tech side of things. So when I moved to that team, I used to have the best numbers for people who close cases, because we all like a little bit of competition. It meant that we had a big board on the wall, and I made sure that my number was always the highest, because, well, why not if you can? And I'm a bit competitive, it turns out. I eventually moved up to be the supervisor for that team. So then I was checking everybody else's scores and making sure that they were getting all of the cases closed that they need to. And after a while, then I was there for 11 years, I became the IT coordinator. So my job ultimately then there was to be the person who set up everybody's new computer and phone system, who looked after servers and patched them and maintained networks and did basically anything that was remotely technical that needed to be done. It came to me to do it at the time. So in the space of those maybe probably 10 years, then I had made a pretty significant jump from not being remotely technical and completely avoiding it to being the one that everybody went to for technical queries and loving every minute of it. I think one of the things that I learned moving into tech as a career is that you don't get a chance to be bored of it. It changes all the time. So I'm never doing the same thing any particular day. There's always different people that I would cross paths with, and always different skills that I'm going to need. And they're not always technical skills that I need too. I think one of my most useful skills is my ability to turn really technical language into ordinary human person language. And that probably comes because I don't have a degree in tech. So I'm not inclined to lean into, you know, using acronyms or super technical terms. And every time somebody explains something to me that's really technical, I have a tendency to go, so do you mean, and I'll make it simpler so that I know I've understood it and I can relay it to the next person there. So after 11 years working in that company, I felt kind of like, okay, I've done everything I can do here. There isn't any higher to go. It was an Irish company. At the time, there wasn't any higher to go technically. And I thought, I'd really like to do something around cybersecurity. This sounds so interesting. This is super cool. You know, you've got good guys and bad guys, exactly as I was raised in the best movies in the world. And I wanted to be on the good guys team as such. So I asked the company that I was with, could we do something? Could we, you know, invest more in cybersecurity? Could I do some study around that? This was 2016, very early stages for all things cybersecurity, and they weren't ready to commit to a significant budget for anything like that yet. So I made the move to Tenable. And in making my move, I essentially stepped down a bit in order to be able to go up further down the line. So what I mean by that is I went back to being in support when I was in Tenable. So I became first line support. And then over, I think it was about 3 years, I moved to second line, then to principal support, which is the ones that take the really complicated issues and work with all of the technical teams inside the company, ask all the questions, find out all the details about how everything works, put it all together like a big jigsaw puzzle, and then take it back to the customer and explain to them in a way that they understand what happened, why it happened, what the fix is, and how to apply it. So then I moved, because, you know, change is important as well. I moved within Tenable into what's called a security engineering team. So the security engineers, our job would be to understand everything that Tenable makes. So Tenable makes software. We make sure that we, with our software, you can find all of the places where you're likely to be attacked by a hacker or be exposed. So I guess it's kind of like we make, you know, if you've got a house with a window open, we're the wind that blows through the house so that you can find it coming out of one of the windows and you go, okay, I need to close that window. So it's our job to make sure that all those cracks and all those open windows are found. And then it's the customer's job to close the window and make sure that all those things are remediated. But what we often would find is that not everybody knows what cybersecurity is, why it's important, how to fix things before you get attacked, also what to do if you do get attacked. But everybody has to know it. From a business perspective, we all are responsible. We have to make sure that everything is safe, but we don't all have to be experts in it as such from there. So the job of a security engineer is really to get on calls and have conversations and meetups with these people, the customers of ours, and make sure that they understand what cyber exposure means. And in our case, that's, you know, understanding where every open window is and every open door and every broken lock. And when they understand that, then we'll tell them how to use what our products to find those holes. And then our products will also tell them how to fix it. So it's our job to walk them through the whole process. So we'll actually spend a good bit of time on calls, not just talking about the products that we use or sell, but talking about the big picture, you know, how other things work with us. What are they doing as general practice around all things cybersecurity? So my conversations and support would have been about specific things that maybe weren't working right. And then my conversations as a sales engineer were about big picture things, talking to lots of different people from lots of different teams about their jobs, what they do, what's difficult about their jobs, what would make their life easier. And then understanding how to show them the best ways to do things and the right ways to do things, and also the ways that are going to be easier for them or mean less time is spent for them trying to do the job so they can get on to other things that are important to them too. And then more recently, I moved from being a security engineer to being a security engineering manager. So now all the people that are in my team do that original work, having those conversations with customers. I hop in from time to time because I still like to sit in and have a chat with customers about everything that's going on. But what's changed for me now is that it's my job to make sure that those people feel happy, basically, that they enjoy their job, that they're comfortable in the company, that they're comfortable in the team, that they have access to any learning and training that they want to do, that if they're having difficult conversations with customers, that I can help them with those conversations and give them some enablement or some support when they're around that. So it's kind of like being a big sister for all of them in other ways. you know, I need to be there to listen to them if they're having problems with things, and I need to be able to either provide them with a solution, a way of getting over that problem, or know somebody who does. So the expectation is that if anyone in my team is unhappy and they come to me with a problem, that I should be able to help them find a solution to that. And that's what I do now.
That's pretty cool.
It is, isn't it? And it changes, like I say, even as a manager, it changes all the time, because as you know, it with cybersecurity, the attacks, the kind of attacks and kind of the people that are causing the problems, it changes so fast, and they've got new ways of doing it. And
exactly,
you know, we always have to come up with new ways of either responding or finding the attacks before they get in the door. So it's kind of like fighting a battle, you know, where I was going to say Pong, but Pong is a game that probably most people's grandparents might do well to remember. But even tennis, you know, you're hitting the ball back one direction and they're hitting it right back at you. So the whole time you have to be ready to catch that ball and hit it back again from there. I like it. That's fast paced, fast moving. And I also have ADHD. So it's very entertaining for somebody like me to do things like that and to have new challenges and more information and things to keep up with. So, you know, with something like ADHD, it's like, you know, I play the game of tennis, but every now and again, I want to play it a little bit faster than everybody else. And, you know, or I might throw in a few fancy shots, but other than that, it's still the same game of tennis. And it interests me.
Yeah. Yeah. And also, you know, there's no guarantee here in this field. Like, it's constantly changing. Nothing is steady except for probably solutions that we come up with. Oh, you know, that happened in the past. So here's this wonderful solution that works really well against that problem. But then the bad guys find another thing and they come in another way, and then you got to do it all over again. So there's no guarantee.
And that's where I think I find some of my past being different. So being from a theatrical background and doing some psychology study, that was not useless training that I had. In fact, that was probably some of the more valuable training for being in cybersecurity, because, well, you have theatrics for starters. So if you're going to speak to lots of people or be able to convey things to people in ways that they understand, you're going to need to be able to adapt and move to that and not being afraid of it, which is something that theater taught me, not to be afraid anymore of anything. If you can stand on the stage and sing a song or make a joke or do a dance, excuse me, then nothing else is going to terrify you after that. And then when it comes to the psychology side of it, like you say, if you're always trying to anticipate the next move, I mean, there's a very human aspect to that. So you've got to be able to think about not just technically what things people might do. They might code or they might target. You need to think about, why would they target it? Like, why is this information important? Why is this potentially an easier way of doing things? And the whys are the bits, again, that are human. So you can have a really deep interest in people and find cybersecurity really, really fascinating, because at the end of the day, that's what's behind it all. Those protecting it and those attacking it, they still have human intention behind it. Usually, you know, it's rarely to steal better code. It's usually to, you know, to get money or to cause damage. Like, so you have to anticipate, why would it be important for somebody to get this information, and why do I have to protect it? And then if I can think about why it's important to them and why they might want it, then I can anticipate how they might go about getting it. And, you know, so like a big
kind of like chess, isn't it?
Yeah.
When you think about it, it's kind of like chess. You anticipate what is going to happen. You try to prevent it. You try to get, you know, one up on them. So it's kind of like chess.
Yes.
Which is, absolutely. It's just now occurring to me when you're talking.
That's exactly it.
Again, it's such a fascinating field to be in. You know, you've come from this varied background, right? You just said you came from theater, you have a background in psychology, and you're able to apply the skills that you learned there, that you've had there, into this field now, where you're able to convert all this technical language into regular, normal people words and explain to them what's going on. And I think that's a very, very useful skill to have.
Yeah.
So I teach this class called Information Security Management. So I work with my students on how to write policies, how to write, you know, incident response plans and all that kind of stuff. But The idea here is to make sure they're able to write in language that everybody else would be able to understand. Because when you think about it, if it comes to the upper level of management, not many people will have that technical background. Not many people will have the ability to understand all of those technical terms. So in order to explain to them, oh, here's why we're doing, you know, steps 1, 2, 3. And, you know, 1.1 is explaining so-and-so or something like that. I think it's a very, very useful skill. And not many people understand that.
No, and the soft skills are something people often underestimate when it comes to cybersecurity. Like if you think about even since I moved to Tenable, if you think about the skills, like, yes, you need to have the technical skills, you need to understand the technology, and you need to be able to use it. But if you're not able to make that, to have a conversation, whether it's with a customer that you're supporting who has a technical issue that you're helping with, or whether it's with a customer who you want to have the big picture conversation with, if you can't talk to them in a relatable way, then it doesn't matter if you've got all the technical skills in the world, you can't actually do what it is that you need to do at the core. And then I've often talked about the people in a company. So I'm lucky enough, I'm in a cybersecurity company making cybersecurity tools. But if I was in a different company, like let's say we made shoes, it's just as important for everybody in that company to understand why cybersecurity is important as it is for the technical people in that company to understand that it's important. Mm-hmm. Because once you put any kind of a computer or iPad or, you know, laptop or phone in front of any of those people, they have the same access to the same networks as everybody else. So they're the same risk, but they have less knowledge. Typically, they have less knowledge. And if you can make somebody who has no technical background understand why it's important, then that's kind of a little bit magic, because there's not very many people that can translate it that way. And it's so important to be able to do it. So for me, anytime I learn anything technical, I always, all the time, I'm thinking about how to make that. And that's because I spend so many years working with customers, how that translates into simple English. And the way I would always say it is that my mother wants to be technical. She's in her mid-70s. You know, she still uses a laptop and she happily plays games on Facebook. And she does some research on her family history. My dad, no. But when my mother will ask me questions about things, like even about what it is that I do, and if I can explain things to her and she walks away feeling like she understands it, then I always kind of commend myself, because I'm like, that's it. I can still do it. I can still make it understandable to anyone. Because she has a mental block to begin with. So you have to get through that barrier. A lot of people are afraid of cybersecurity. You know, they're like, are you a hacker or are you a defender? Or is it all code or is it all bots? Or, you know, what is it exactly? And so if you can make it something that they can understand and make it less scary for them, then more people are going to be able to listen to the rest of the information about it, you know, what they can do to protect themselves or their families or their business. But you can't get that far if they're already frightened of the concept. Like they need to realize that we're all in need of cybersecurity every day, and we're all using tools that need that kind of protection every day, even though you might not know it. You know, you use Siri to turn your lights on at home. You know, you need to know about cybersecurity. So, yeah.
Exactly. And it also, the way media portrays cybersecurity also comes into play here. You know, that's a huge factor. When people that don't have firsthand knowledge, firsthand experience with technical fields, they see all these movies, you know, they just like the good guys, bad guys, doesn't matter who they are. They're like, they're just typing away and they say, oh, I'm in. I'm able to, you know, edit or alter this traffic, you know, camera footage, or I'm able to alter the security footage from here. That's very scary. Yes, it's possible, but the way the media, you know, whether it's in videos or news articles, blog posts, whatever it is, the way they portray the field also plays into that.
It's never as efficient as they make it look in the movies. Never. I know one thing that always makes me laugh when I watch movies is when they put in like a memory key. For starters, any good company won't allow that memory key to work in their business, just saying. But if they put a memory key in and they're going to copy over a file, and this is the file for a piece of software that has, you know, some sort of AI technology, it's going to take over the world, and they copy it over in less than a minute. Never. that's going to be a huge piece of software and it's not going to fit on a memory and it's not going to copy over in a minute. The same with when they go tappity tap tap tap, I'm in. We all know, like, if it's a government body, you're not going to be, even with the best of intelligence, you're not going to be hacking into it in under 3 minutes. You know, you're going to have to work a lot harder at that. And the chances are someone's going to know that you're there when you're doing it. And, but yeah, that doesn't make for good TV viewing. But it does make hackers much more interested in hacking.
Yes.
So this is why you have to have that real kind of good cop, bad cop mentality. So do you want to be the person that protects against these hackers? Because the hackers are always bad guys in the movies, at least. And sometimes they're just people who didn't mean to, sometimes didn't mean any harm, but were just playing. But they still do harm in doing that. It's still not something that they should do. So to consider the, to being the good guys, as they say, in this is important to keep that kind of mentality. And that's ultimately what we do. It doesn't matter whether you're selling the software that people use to protect against the good guys, or whether you're one of the people that identify as an attack, or bad guy, sorry, identify as an attack and then stops it in its track. Either way, you're on the good side. And that's where most of us would prefer to be. And that's why ethical hacking is a great way of crossing that boundary as such. You know, if you are really interested in hacking and getting into places you shouldn't be and doing things you shouldn't do, then if you go down the route of ethical hacking, you get to feel all those great excitement feelings, but whilst also doing good. And that's really, you know, that's where put all your energy into those things and change the world for the better, rather than, you know, getting a headline in a newspaper for the wrong reasons, and that's it, you got heard of for one day, you know?
Yeah, makes a lot of sense too. And again, that psychology part plays a huge role in how we perceive different things. If you're always seeing negative words or negative things about something, you're always going to be a little scared of it. You know, even if it's just people, when you talk negative about certain people, over a period of time, you develop that kind of fear, you develop that kind of anxiety over working with that person or so. So it makes much more sense. Absolutely. So then your transition into technology came organically then, right? That is fantastic.
It was almost accidental, as I say. I always say I tripped and fell into it. But I guess if I look back, like, the signs were there. I mean, when I was a little kid, I played on a Spectrum ZX, which you should Google because it looks kind of cool. But it was old school, like, where we had cassette tapes for loading games, and it took about 15 minutes to load a game, and you played two levels, you know. And it was originally bought for my brothers, and then, you know, myself and my younger sister would have played it with them. But I was always the one that would stay behind and code in. I don't think it was a Spectrum at that stage, but used to code in these big, long alphanumeric codes that went on for pages and pages and pages just so you could skip a level. You know, I weirdly enjoyed doing that. I quite liked it and had the patience for it. And then as I got older, I had an aunt that was a volunteer in a local church. And then I taught all of the nuns in that church how to use laptops because they'd never used any technology before. And I was, even any shops that I worked in when I was younger, I worked in shoe stores and clothes stores and sweet stores. It was always me that fixed the tills or the registers, that, you know, knew how to reload the credit card machines. It just naturally, everywhere I went, that ended up being the thing that I did, no matter how much I thought I was avoiding it by working in non-technical roles. I still ended up being the one using all the technical kit in those roles. So even though I say I tripped and fell into the role, I think if it hadn't have been in that particular company, it would have been somewhere else, because it was clearly something that I was meant to do, if you look at it like that, because it followed me everywhere I went from a small child to now. It was just about me going, all right, then let's lean into this. And once I did decide, OK, let's give this a go and see what it's like. I mean, the last 18 years for me have been so fast. And then when I look back and I realize how much learning I've done and how much change there has been over those 18 years, it's been, like, on paper, it seems phenomenal. To me, it seems 18 years. Like, it is 18 years, which, you know, to most of the people here will be a ridiculously long time, but it was felt so, so short. And to have changed everything I do in that space of time, you know, all down to just tripping and falling into it, as I say. But clearly, if you have an aptitude for these things, I think you'll find that you'll just end up in it one way or another. And that's what happened with me. Yeah.
Yeah. Kind of like a happy accident.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Getting better every day too. So it hasn't got any less cool since I've gone into it just more and more day by day. Yeah.
Makes a lot of sense. So you have so much experience in cybersecurity, right? From vulnerability remediation to industrial security to team management. So far, what has been the most challenging thing for you to learn in cybersecurity then?
For me, it was probably coding. So I have done, like, back when I was in college, I did a multimedia course, another thing I did, forgot about that one. But it was like media writing and photography and calligraphy. But there was one course on it where we did HTML coding. And bear in mind, I was 19, so we're talking nearly 25 years ago. And I loved it then. So I thought, this time around when I was learning Python, I was like, sure, this will be great. I love it. It's so much easier now than it was then, because back then everything was manual. There was no copying bits or patching it together. But when I went to learn Python, it was just not for me. I can read it and I can change it, but when it comes to writing it from scratch, I probably found that the single most difficult thing that I've ever had to do. And now I can do it, but it's not something that I favor. And it doesn't make me any less technical or any less capable than anybody else that I work with. Like I say, I can still apply it when I have to, but I will avoid it at all costs because I find it so difficult. And you know, coding is not for everybody. Coding is a very, you need a lot of discipline. You need to have imagination to code if you're going to do it from scratch. And you need to have purpose. You want to be coding for something that you're going to be able to see the end results of, or at least, you know, see the part of it that you're involved in. Because in many cases, when people are doing that, they're one of many coding towards one big goal. Whereas for me, I've always preferred being in front of other humans and being more hands-on, I guess, in that respect, rather than backroom, as I would refer to it. I found the environment quiet, and that was difficult. And again, that could be ADHD too, because, you know, being quiet and concentrating on something for that length of time was never my strong point. But I was too stubborn to not be able to do it. So I still am able to do it. But I make sure that I do things that the parts of it that I enjoy more now. And I can, because, excuse me, in cybersecurity, there's so much room and scope to be able to go, well, you know, I can do a little bit of coding, but I'm going to do this now. And, you know, even with regards going into a company and working in a specific role, most companies will allow you to move around. If you're good at the job that you do, if you're a good employee, they'll allow you to move around inside that company too, which is what happened for me in Tenable, to move from support into security engineering. And I've known lots and lots of people that have gone into cybersecurity and changed. They've just gone, okay, I've been a SOC engineer for years, and now I want to do development or research. And it's one of those few careers that you can really move around in, and all of the skills are transferable. Everything. Doesn't matter what you've done in the past. If it's anything to do with cybersecurity, it's absolutely going to be relevant to the next role you move into.
And it also comes in, like, you play to your strengths. Right. We all have our strengths. And sometimes with some people, it's that quiet, you know, coding environment. For some people, it's that social human interaction. And we always, you know, why not play to our strengths? Yes, we have to focus on our weaknesses. Yes, we have to try to, you know, at least overcome it. But if it's making you, you know, feel terrible, if it's making you feel anxious and nervous, then maybe that's not quite the way to go.
Yeah, there's no point in trying to force yourself to be, I wouldn't even say to be something that you're not, because I think we've all the capabilities to be anything that we want to, but there's no point in trying to force yourself to be something you don't enjoy. Like,
yes,
it is possible. And I teach my own kids this. So I've got four boys, and I say kids, but they're like 25, 19, 16 and 9. So only one of them really is small still, but I try and teach them that, you know, you can do whatever job you want to do. But if you don't like it, it doesn't matter if it's paying you $1 million or $100. You're not going to want to do it. You have to like the job that you're doing. So it's really important that if something gives you joy, or you just simply look forward to doing it, then do that. Make that the thing that you do. And for me, like, I've always loved cybersecurity. It's always intrigued me. There's always been lots of learning involved in it, and it changes so fast. So I'm 7 years now working specifically in cybersecurity. And it feels like a heartbeat, because it's still changing and moving and fast and exciting. So I've not begun to get bored of it yet anyway. And I think that's the key for me. Nothing else mattered than once I was happy doing what I'm doing. It also helps that the company that I work for is great and it has a great culture. I mean, if you're going to work for a company that's going to support you and going to work with you on your goals and stuff too, that's also going to be useful when you make these kind of choices. But most importantly, yes, you must enjoy what you're doing to be able to actually do it for longer. It's a long time, and a career is a long time.
That's true. So you are a member of the WSIS community, the Women in Cybersecurity community, right? So over the years, since you've been a part of that community, have you seen, the industry, the cybersecurity industry as a whole, evolving in terms of diversity, in terms of inclusion? Have you seen that change, or are you like, how do you feel about that?
I'm seeing the change. Of course, it's not nearly as fast as I would like to see it, but it is happening. What I'm enjoying the most about, so there's different levels to these kind of changes. Like, so you have to have women on boards and in the executive roles and at sea levels, because like we discussed earlier, there's a feeling that you cannot be what you can't see. So you need to be able to see women on these boards for other women to go, yeah, I could do that. I can be a director and I can be an executive and I can be a CISO or a CEO. So we need to see more of that at that level. And then when you consider kind of middle management or women, say between 25 and 45, we see a lot of them leaving the industry because there's pressure. Like, we are so far the only ones that can have children. So there's a lot of pressure typically for women to be the ones to look after children and then to also keep a heavy workload at the same time. So to have a company that supports some changes around those new needs means that we would keep those women in the roles longer and they can still continue to parent their children. It's just about making some slight adjustments. Maybe they work from home more often. Maybe they change their hours slightly so that they can do school runs or childcare drop-offs. We're talking about very small and very subtle changes to be able to keep the numbers that we need in the workforce for longer. And then earlier than that, you're talking about people that are coming into the roles. And we have done much better with regards to having non-biased recruitment. So instead of using recruitment tools to identify only the best candidate, we don't want it to be biased against women or people in certain locations or people with certain backgrounds or because of their names or whatever it is. So there's a lot of technology now that strips all of that out. So you're genuinely just looking at somebody's qualifications and career against another person's qualifications and career and putting the right person in the job. That's made it better for people going in, but there's still a lot of challenges for some companies where they're not making it clear about where they stand on the support for women in tech. So a lot more companies out there are actually supportive of it and more supportive than we realize. They just aren't telling us. I don't understand why they wouldn't. But I found, like, I've spoken to many women that are like, I love it. I love where I work. They're great. They support everything I need. They're flexible. They've been fab when I've been on maternity leave. They've helped me when things, I've moved house or changed family or I wanted to change career. They've had everything there. And I'm like, really? I never heard anything about that. They should absolutely be singing those songs from the rooftops, because there's other women that, and every woman I know that's looking for jobs or moving jobs anywhere, will absolutely do their research on these companies. So if that company isn't telling people that they offer all these supports and are a great, have a great culture and are a great community to be in, then how are these women going to know? And why would they apply for a job with you? And it seems really, really obvious, but it's surprisingly a bigger issue than you think. And then we go earlier again when we get into schools. And what I love about this generation that are still in school, whether it's in I don't know what it's called in the States. So here it's called primary school. So that's like 12 and under. And then the secondary schools, then it's called here, which is high school there. They won't stand for anything that we've put up with in the past. And I love that. So if they want to do a job, they'll do a job. They don't care if men are the only people that have ever done that job in the past. They don't care if anyone has told them that they shouldn't do it or couldn't do it. They're just going to do it because it's what they want to do anyway. And that's fantastic. We can learn. We being me at the other end of it, the older end of it. I can and am learning so much from this next generation of girls and women that are only at the early stages. Some of them haven't even made it into the workforce yet. You're talking maybe up to the very early 20s. And it's mind blowing how much personal power these women and these girls have. And sometimes I wonder, do they even know it? How inspiring they are to us. So there's a tendency. I was raised in the, you know, respect your elders and learn from people that have gone before you and stuff. But it's very easy to forget how much we can learn from the generations coming after us. And it blows my mind time after time after time when I'm speaking to these women who are just starting to get into it or are still studying it, how much I can learn from them. And I cannot wait till they all hit the workforce properly. And that's when the real change is going to happen. I think it's the kids and the, you know, from whatever, toddlers up to maybe 20 now, when they all get into the workforce, the game is going to change completely. And I'm so excited for that. Will I still be in the workforce? Yes. Yes. How many mess? Yes, I'll still be in the workforce. I won't have retired yet, so I'll still be there to see it firsthand, hopefully from an executive or a C-level role. But I cannot wait to see it. I really can't.
Me too. And I also think some of it has to do with, you know, how, or not just how, but with like generational differences. You know, with the younger folks, they've seen the struggles that their aunts, mothers, all of them have gone through, and they're not wanting to continue that. They're not wanting to stand up for it anymore, and they're demanding more, which in turn is causing these companies, these industries, and all of these bigwigs to kind of see from their point of view as well. Yes, we are, you know, even if we have children, even if we have so many other things going on, we still want to be, you know, considered for these positions because we are qualified. We have the skill, we have the, you know, educational qualifications or certifications, whatever is needed. We have all of that. So why not consider us? Why not be a little bit more flexible around it, which is beneficial to everybody all around, not just for the company or for that particular individual, but for us as a collective.
So. Absolutely. And like, we never ask for a lot. That's the funny thing. We should, but we never ask for a lot. So we literally ask for a little bit of a change around the working day to accommodate having a life as well, or a different approach to learning, or, you know, a different structure to whatever goal we're trying to achieve. Because the way it's been done for years has been done primarily in a workforce of men for hundreds and hundreds of years. So we're just asking for a tweak, just a teeny tweak. You know, we're not asking for the whole world to spin in the opposite direction. So if the roles were reversed, I'm quite sure the asks would be so much more significant, and there would be no apologizing for asking for those things. But because we still have those generational impacts of, you know, be grateful for what you've got, which is true.
And it's also that assumed or expected responsibility or expected behavior kind of. Yes. That causes us to not ask exactly what we want. So,
So I think for any woman that is in cybersecurity or in tech now, you need to go find yourself. Sorry, this tractor is going by my house. If you can hear all that, it's that time of the year. But you need to go find yourself some younger women and spend some time with them, because we spend such a lot of time thinking that we're going to empower younger women, and then I speak to them and I go, "Hang on there, teach me some more." You know, I've got so much to learn about holding my own in a space and about not expecting any less than I deserve. And the generation that's teaching us now are the ones that are in schools telling their teachers how to teach things too. Do you know, it's fantastic.
Yeah, I can't wait for them to enter the workforce either.
Same here.
Yeah. Well, unfortunately, we're almost out of time. So I'll just close our session with a last question. Now, what is one piece of advice that you would give to all the young people that are watching this recording?
It would be to try it all. Don't assume you're not going to like something. Don't assume you're not going to be good at anything. Every opportunity that comes your way, go, okay, I'll give it a go. What's the worst that can happen? If you're no good at it, well, sure, then you don't have to give it a go twice. If you don't like it, then you still don't have to do it twice. But if you do it once, then you're going to learn from that experience what you like, what you don't, and what you're going to do better the next time around. So no matter what it is, if somebody comes to you with an opportunity, and by an opportunity, that could be something as simple as, you know, should we meet up and have a coffee? And do that with safety, obviously. But do that and make sure that you've learned something from it. Like, take all the opportunities that come and make sure that you allow other people to be the ones to take them from you. Don't take them from yourself. So make sure you do it.
I love that. I really do. And it's really difficult, you know, sometimes when we get in our own heads, when we get in our own mind, it's hard for us to see the big picture. Oh, you know, they're asking to meet for a coffee, like you just said. What's the worst that could happen? Yeah. And I get to meet them. They've been working in this field for so long. Maybe I'll get to pick their brain a bit. You know, maybe I'll get to see what they do exactly, you know, if it's something that I'm interested in. So I love that.
Here's an example of it, actually. Sorry, before I let you go, is that I wanted to be involved in all things women in tech back in 2018, I think it was. And I remember I was doing a 4-hour commute during the day, a full day's work, 4 kids at home. And I was like, how am I going to find the time to do this? So I decided that I'm going to say yes to anything that comes my way that has to do with women in tech, handing out flyers, you know, publishing, republishing events or whatever it is, anything at all. 9 months later, I was in the convention center in Dublin, which is one of the biggest it's one of the biggest places where you'll have events in the city. And I was on the main stage speaking to 1200 people at a women in tech event. It was less than a year later, I was able to get that far down the road by simply just saying yes to opportunities as they come. And I've mentored people and told them, you know, do this for a bit, do it for a week, do it for a month, do it for a year and see what comes of it. And so far yet, there hasn't been one that said it was a waste of time, not one. So there's your example.
That's awesome. And again, just take the opportunity, make good use of the opportunity that you were given. So fantastic. Thank you so much for being on CybHER Conversations today. We really appreciate you taking time out of your day.
Thanks for having me.